Praise the Lord.
Hallelujah.
Good evening, good afternoon, good day, everybody. How am I today? And you too? Well, praise the Lord for this new development. And it's going to develop something in your life. Something in your family. And something in your ministry in Jesus' name. I just want you to pray that this day will be a special day for you. Things you've never seen, and things you've never known, and things you've never experienced will be your lot today. Nothing will stand between you and your blessing. In Jesus' name we pray. Father, in the name of Jesus, we come to bless your name today. Thank you for your goodness. Thank you for your grace. Thank you for your power. Thank you for thinking about us. We're asking, O Lord, that every individual today will receive a definite touch of the Lord in Jesus' name. Lord, we pray you remember us for good. That you do something in every life that will stir us up, that will encourage us, and that will put your power, your dynamite in every life to move on and to do your work more in Jesus' name. Let your work prosper in our hands. I will pray, Lord, that souls will come into the kingdom and men will be restored as you bring your power to bear upon every one of our lives. Bless your people today and make us channels of blessings to everybody we'll meet after this time. We thank you because we know you have answered. In Jesus' name we pray. Thank you. You can see that. We're looking at 2 Samuel, and I'm reading from verse 1 of chapter 7. 2 Samuel chapter 7, and we're reading from verse 1. It says, "And it came to pass, when the king sat in his house, and the Lord had given him rest round about from all his enemies, that the king said unto Nathan the prophet, See now, I dwell in an house of cedar, but the ark of God dwelleth within curtains. And Nathan said to the king, Go, do all that is in thine heart, for the Lord is with thee." We'll come to verse 4. "And it came to pass that night that the word of the Lord came unto Nathan, saying, Go and tell my servant David, Thus says the Lord, Shalt thou build me an house for me to dwell in?" Let's stop there for a moment. In that passage of scripture, you know the story perhaps. David had something to do. A good intention in heart, and a good motivation in heart, and a good desire. And he said, look at the palace, and look at where the ark of the Lord is. Looks like the palace, that is the place I live, is greater. It's more beautiful. It's more desirable than the tent or the curtain under which the ark of the Lord was. And so he said, Nathan the prophet, I'm thinking of doing something. Isn't it wonderful that you would have the opportunity to ask for counseling? Even a king, even a leader, to say, I'm thinking of this, I'm planning this, can I do this? And Nathan thought it was the right thing. It was a good thing. Building for the Lord, I'm building an edifice better than the palace, I'm bringing the ark of the covenant there. He said, go do that which is in your heart. That night, the Lord came to Nathan and said, go tell David that you made a mistake, that you encouraged him to do what I didn't want him to do. Go tell him, you said yes, I have said no. And then Nathan had to come back to David to say, you know what? That good thing in your heart and that great thing you want to do, God said no. I want to tell you that David will be disappointed. And David will feel, this is the greatest I thought I'll do for God. And now God is saying, I shouldn't do it. And as you read the whole story, which you are going to get to later, you will see the great thing that came out of this. That's why I'm talking to you tonight on rising from disappointment to his appointment. Rising from disappointment to his appointment. Actually, if you look at those words I gave you now, number one, disappointment. Number two, his appointment. There's only one difference of a letter. The D at the beginning of disappointment and the H at the beginning of his appointment. If you change that single letter from D and you change it to H, you're going to have his appointment. Now, what you might think is a delay. Replace that D with the H of hope. And then you're going to find everything will turn around. You look at your life and it's like you wanted to do something, wanted to go somewhere, you wanted to achieve something. And God is saying no. That's a denial. And you replace that with hope or with help. And you're going to find that what you thought was a denial, what you thought was a delay, actually something good is going to come out of it. That's why you look at your life, you look at the past, and you think of since the time you knew the Lord, I wanted to do this, I wanted to do that. I remember such and such a time, I wanted to go that direction. It appeared there was a delay, a denial, a disappointment. And now as you look at the result today, you find that that disappointment has become his appointment. And as you live the rest of your life, there are many things that will happen. You will say, I'm going to do this, I'm going to climb that mountain, I'm going to achieve that. Temporarily, it may appear that God is saying no. How could God say no? This is a wonderful thing. This is a great thing. And this is the greatest I thought I was going to do for the Lord. And then a no is coming from the throne. A denial is coming from the throne. A delay is coming from the throne of God. And you might feel disappointment, but disappointed rather. But from today, there's no disappointment in your life. You're going to find out that every disappointment will be changed to his appointment. Just by that change of the D to the H. In fact, we're told, those who have, thought about this, they said, God is a master planner. And you know that. He is a master planner. There are things in your life that you want to plan this way and plan this way, put this up and fix that one. But God, the master planner, he will do everything correct in your life. So that's what we're talking about, rising from disappointment to his appointment. I'm going to divide the message to three parts. Number one, the holy resolve of a grateful king. The holy resolve. That means determination. That means his plan. That means the decision you are taking. This is what I'm going to do. The holy resolve of a grateful king. Number two, the heavenly response of the glorious king with a capital K. That's referring to the God of heaven. The heavenly response of the glorious king. And then number three, the higher reward of a greater kingdom. The higher reward. What he wasn't planning for. What he wasn't expecting. What he wasn't thinking God will give him as a result of that desire, that motive. And as a result of that plan, what he wanted to do for the Lord. He discovered that something he never bargained for came his way. And this is going to be fulfilled in your life. You're going to find out the things you didn't expect and the things you didn't even pray about or think about is coming your way. Amen. Am I talking to some workers there today? It will happen. And this year will be a year of joy, a year of happiness in every one of our lives in Jesus' name. Let's come to point number one. Point number one, the holy resolve of a grateful king. Let's come to verse 1. In chapter 7, verse 1. And it came to pass when the king sat in his house, and the Lord had given him rest round about from all his enemies. Actually, this is why David was grateful. He was grateful to the Lord. He was thinking of all that had happened to him. He was thinking of all the provision the Lord had given to him. Number one, a personal house built. A personal house built. And he looked at himself, the youngest in his family. And he said, look at me. A personal house has been built. Number two, powerful enemies conquered. All the enemies around him, he conquered. Like you are going to conquer. This year, no enemy will see your face frowning and gloomy, because this year is a year of joy. Amen. Victory, victory all the way for us in Jesus' name. Amen. Number three, a priestly position established. The Lord established him as a king, like a prince. And then number four, the presence of God. Of God, the ark enjoyed. Look at them one by one. Look at chapter 5. I'm reading from verse 11. Chapter 5, verse 11. And Hiram, king of Tyre, sent messengers to David, and cedar trees, and carpenters, and were told, and masons. And they built David an house. And they built David and house. Help came from everywhere. Finance came from everywhere. And wood came from everywhere. All the materials they will use, and even the carpenters, they mentioned the carpenters. Everything came from everywhere. Your helpers are coming. And all the people that, all those things you are dreaming about, all those things you are thinking about, can I have this, can I have this, can I have that? Maybe you don't have a salary that will cover everything. You don't have all the provision that will cover everything. The helpers are coming. They will soon get to you. And it says, they built him an house. Not only that, powerful enemies were conquered. All enemies against your life. The Lord is going to give you victory this year. All the things in the day, in the night, victory has come already. Look at chapter 7, verse 9. In chapter 7, verse 9, and I was with thee, whithersoever thou wentest. Everywhere you go, the Almighty God will be with you. Underneath you will be the everlasting arms. And I've cut off all thine enemies. He has cut off all mine enemies. Say it for yourself. He has cut off all my enemies. You believe that?
Yes.
It will be done.
Yes.
And then it says, out of thy sight, and have made thee a great name, like unto the name of the great men that are in the earth. That's what God said he had done for him. That's why the man was grateful. He said, look at me. Look at my surrounding. And look at a personal house. And look at the powerful enemies that are totally destroyed. And then a princely position established. Come to chapter 5 and verse 12. Chapter 5 verse 12. And David perceived that the Lord had established him king over Israel. You're going to perceive the promotion this year. In your place of work, in your communities, anywhere you are, because your hand is on the plow, and your hand is working the work of God, is going to reward you this year. He will establish you in Jesus' name. And then it says, and that he had exalted his kingdom for his people Israel's sake. Not only that, the presence of God, that's the ark of God, was returned to the land. And that was now, that presence was now enjoyed. Chapter 6, I'm reading from verse 17. You see why David was grateful. That at his own time, the ark of the covenant that had been taken away for a long, long time, that ark has come back. The presence of God will come to your family. Will come to your local church. And you will see that his presence will achieve, will do things in your family and your life. Anywhere you go, everywhere you go, that nobody can do for you. Let's look at chapter 6 and verse 17. In verse 17 of chapter 6, here is what it says. And they brought in the ark of the Lord and set it in his place in the midst of the tabernacle that David had pitched for it. And David offered burnt offering and peace offerings before the Lord. That's what the Lord has done. As you look at David and you see why he was thinking about it, he said, all around I have peace. All around I have prosperity. All around I have provision. All around I have protection. Because of that, see what God has done for me. I'm going to do this for God. And he said, what can I do for God? Then he remembered, look at the ark of God under the tent somewhere there. And look at the beautiful house of cedar where I'm living. Okay, I know what I'm going to do. I'm going to build something. A great edifice for the Lord. Like we're going to develop this place. And it's going to be a great edifice in Jesus' name. And it's not going to be a long time. The next time the meeting brings us here again, I'll say, wow, this place has changed. Already I see the change, but I'm going to see greater change in Jesus' name. And now all the people that have hand in that, all the people that even you contribute whatever you have, you are going to see that there will be multiplied contribution to your business. Multiplied blessings to your family. Because that's how God does. I read of a particular farmer, and this is a true story. It's a Christian farmer. And every time, you know, the other farmers all around, they looked at him because, you know, they have their field here, and that farmer over there, and that farmer over there. And they saw that, you know, he will not come on Sunday to the farm. All the other people say, me, I must be there in the farm every time. They say, this is sowing season, and this is, you know, whatever. But this man, Sunday, is back to church. And then on Monday, he'll come. And they happen to know that the man was also paying tithes and offering. And then his field was greener than their own. His crops were greater than their own. They were wondering, how is he? Then they have been discussing behind him, what's happening to this man? We thought he was foolish. And we thought he doesn't know how to spend his time. You know, church, and tithes and offering and all that. And yet, he is being promoted and he's getting richer than us. And then, so they summoned up here and they called him. They said, we need to meet with you. We want to discuss with you. So he said, that's all right. And then he came to them and he said, we want to understand your secret. You are always the way you give time to God. And you are always spending your these tithes and offering, which we don't believe. They didn't believe that. And he said, and yet you are becoming richer than everybody around here. And he said, yes, I'll tell you the secret. And so they said, okay, tell us the secret. He said, you know, when I pay tithes, I shovel to God. And then when I shovel to God, God shovels back to me. They say, yes, we understand. Well, that's all right. You shovel to God, he shovels back to you. How is it that, you know, you're still so rich? Oh, he said, God uses a bigger shovel. And you know, in your life, he'll use a bigger shovel. The shovel to God. And then you think he's going to shovel back to you. Just what to shovel to? No, it's a greater shovel. And you think of God, a mighty God. You think of the size of a shovel. I cannot tell you. When that thing comes back to you, you'll know the size of a shovel. And so that's what the Lord is telling us, that this man, he showed gratitude to God. And as you think about what he said he wanted to do, there are three things here. Number one, a glorious project. A glorious project. Look at the project he had in mind that he said was going to put together. A glorious project. Number two, a great passion. He had this passion within him. What he wanted to do for God. And then number three, a godly perspective. A godly perspective. Look at it one by one. A glorious project. What's the project? Come to verse 2. Chapter 7, verse 2. It says, then the king said unto Nathan the prophet, see now, I dwell in an house of cedar. But the ark of the Lord, the ark of God, dwelleth within the courtyards. What did he have in mind here? He was looking at the ark as the representation of God. Representation of God. And he wanted to build a dwelling place. He wanted to build a house. He wanted to build a habitation unto for that ark, so that will be a habitation for the Lord himself. Isn't that what all the people of God what they have said in the past. Once you belong to God and you see what he has done for you, he saved your soul, he delivered you, he healed you, he separated you from all the people of the world, there is gratitude in your heart. Look at Exodus chapter 15. Exodus chapter 15. You remember the story? Let my people go, that they may serve me. And eventually God delivered the children of Israel, their redemption, their salvation. That was it. And not only that, they came to the Red Sea. When they came to the Red Sea, it's like Pharaoh pursued them. It's like they were going to be destroyed. But no, they were not going to perish because God was on their side. And God is on your side. I said God is on your side. This Red Sea before you will not swallow you up. You will pass through. Somebody there said you will pass through. The miracle of God will be performed on your side in Jesus' name. After that miracle of redemption, after that miracle of deliverance, after that miracle of protection, then the people said, look at this now, and this is how grateful we are. You know, there are people, they've been in the church for, I don't know, 3 years, 4 years, 5 years, and you ask them, are you a worker? Oh, they say, I don't have time. He has saved them, they don't have time for God. He has healed them, they don't have time for God. He has provided for them, they don't have time for God. And all the exams they took, he made them to pass the exam, no time for God. He's giving them a job. There are many graduates in town that don't have any job. They've got a job. With all he has done for them, they say, I don't have any time. But not David and not these children of Israel. You see, when God has blessed you, when God has done something for you, even waking up, sleeping and waking up in the morning, do you know how many people that slept last night and this morning they are gone already? We're hearing that they are no more here. They have gone to eternity. And he's doing all that for you. Say, you don't have time. Thank God you have time. If you know any friend who has been in the church for a long time, and then when we're coming for the workers' meeting, they are going in another place, and they say they don't have time, you go and plead with them. And if you win another person, I'm not saying now you win a sinner to the kingdom, that's your business. You're going to do that. But you're going to do something now. You're going to win a believer, a worker into the workforce. I'm talking to somebody. You know, a believer is a child of God. And you know, sometimes when you discuss together, you see his knowledge of the Bible. You look at his life, he's not compromising. He's a real child of God. And you know that this person, he knows as much as I know. He can do as much as I'm doing. He can preach what I'm preaching. And he's a faithful child of God, but he's not a worker. Through you, he'll be a worker. And because that's what we do, and your blessing, the blessing is going to come upon them. And when the blessing comes upon them, it's a plash unto you. You have your own blessing because you are a worker. You are now an extra blessing because you bring another one. Didn't you do that to your place of work? You are working in a particular place, and then as you are working there, they said, do you know anybody who will like your work? Anybody in your church? Anybody just like you that will not steal our money? That will behave like this, that will do his work well. Oh yes, she say, I know. They say, go and call them. And then you know somebody in your district, you know somebody in the church, you said, there is an opening vacancy in our place of work. Have you heard of something like that before? Has somebody done that before? Don't raise up your hand, but has somebody done that before? Uh-huh. We do that, and then you take them there, and the person is working well, and your director will call you and say, you know, this person you brought is wonderful. It's just like you. Because of him, they raise your salary. Because of the worker you are going to bring, God is going to raise your salary. Yeah. It's going to say, I've been doing this for you before, but for this one you have done, that you have brought another worker in, something good is going to happen to you. In Exodus chapter 15, I'm reading here from verse 2. Exodus chapter 15, we're looking at verse 2. And the Lord is my strength and my song, and he is become my salvation. He is my God, and I will prepare him, tell me, an habitation. That's what Moses here, that's what was saying. And that's what the children of Israel, that's what they were saying. I will prepare him, I will provide him, I will build him a habitation. It tells us there is my father's God, and I will exalt him. And that word habitation, let's chase that word. You're looking at Ephesians chapter 2. Ephesians chapter 2. Here I am reading from verse 20. Ephesians. We're looking at chapter 2, and we're reading from verse 20 here. Ephesians chapter 2, verse 20. Look at what the Lord is telling us here. It says, and are built upon the foundation of the apostles. It's talking about believers. It's talking about children of God. It's talking about we who are Christians who are built into a temple. The church is called a temple. The church is called a fold. The church is called a family. And it says, as we're bringing them one by one and we're being built together, it says we're built up upon the foundation of the apostles and the prophets, Jesus Christ himself being the chief cornerstone. Look at verse 21. In whom all the building, fitly joined, fitly framed together, grows up into an holy temple in the Lord. Verse 22. In whom ye also are builded together. Tell me the rest. For an habitation of God. You see, as we are winning souls to the kingdom of God, as we are bringing believers, they are being turned from sinners to saints, from unbelievers to believers, and they become members of the body of Christ. It says they are built up an habitation unto the Lord, habitation of God through the Spirit. Number one, a glorious project. That's the project David had in mind. I'm going to build a habitation for him. And this is the project we have in mind here as we are reaching out to those sinners and we are bringing them in. We're building an habitation unto the Lord. Number two is a great passion. A great passion. You see the passion he had with all his heart, with all his soul. Look at 1 Kings chapter 14. 1 Kings chapter 14. And see the testimony of the Almighty God himself concerning this David. It tells us in 1 Kings chapter 14. And I'm reading here from verse 8. In verse 8, the Lord actually was talking to another person, but now he had to make reference to David. And that reference to David then showed the passion that David had for the Lord. Verse 8, it says, and wrenched the kingdom away from the house of David, and gave it unto thee. And yet thou hast not been as my servant David. You know, David had gone already, but God's still making reference to him. After you have left, after you've done a full day's job, a full life's job, and your life has been glorious, you go to the other side, heaven will still be talking about you. And the church will still be talking about you. And the legacy you leave behind will still be talking about that in Jesus' name. And it says, my servant David, who kept my commandments and who followed me with all his heart. Who followed me? That's God talking about David. Who followed me? That's God testifying about David. Who followed me with all his heart to do that only which was right in mine eyes. That was the passion of David. And that's the glorious passion, the great passion you God is expecting that you have. And God can testify about you. I know that man, I know that woman, I know that son, I know that daughter. With all their hearts, they wanted to really serve me and to follow me with great, great passion. And look at 1 Chronicles chapter 29. 1 Chronicles chapter 29. This man, David, he was really a great lover of God. I pray that this same heart the Lord will give unto you in Jesus' name. You know, if everyone, every worker, if every member of the church could just have this kind of heart. Let me remind you that David wanted to build a habitation for the ark of the Lord. He wanted to build a shelter. He wanted to build a kind of a church, what we call church building today, for that ark of the Lord. And God said, no, you're not going to do it. Your son will do it. You know, some people, if they had a good intention and they had a good project and they had a good motive, I want to do this great thing for the Lord. And then God says, no, they're disappointed. They don't know how to change their D to an H. They're disappointed. They don't know how to change a delay to heavenly help. They're disappointed. They don't know how to change a denial to hope in the Lord. And so they'll be going about, they'll be telling everybody, you know, they didn't allow, I wanted to do that thing. I'm older than Solomon. I'm older than so and so. What's Solomon going to do that I cannot do? I could have done that. They'll be going about complaining. But David said, I'm not to build that, no problem. But I'm going to do something. See what he did. In 1 Chronicles chapter 29, and I'm reading from verse 1. It says, furthermore, David the king said unto all the congregation, Solomon my son, whom alone God has chosen, is yet young and tender. And the work is great. The work is great. For the palace is not for man, but for the Lord God. You think about that. It says, now children of Israel, this one we're building is not for man. I'm going to ask you a question now. When you are building your house, you are married, you have children, and now you've got a land somewhere. And then you say, it's time to build for my family. I want to stop paying rents. Now you've got that land. How long does it take to build? Some people take just 1 year and they are through. Some people take just 2 years, 3 years and they are through. And now they park to their house. And then you get to that place and see the compound. And you see the ceiling, everything, within about 2 or 3 years. Now, difficult question. 1 million naira question. Okay, they talk about billions now in Nigeria. They don't talk about millions anymore. You read the papers, it's a billion naira, 4 billion, 2 point something billion. They even talk of trillions now. But let me ask you a 1 billion naira question. Since have we started building this place? How many years? 2 years? 5 years? When did we get here? Anybody telling me? 1989. Okay, 1989. If you say from 90 to 2000, that's 10. 2000 to 2010, that's 20. And then to this time now, that's 16. And then the other one, 89, that's how many years? 20. What? 27 years. If it were your own house, for yourself and mommy, your wife and your children, 27 years. Think about that. David said, look at the house where I'm living and look at the tent where the ark of the Lord is. He said, I'm going to abandon my own. I'm going to get this done and we're going to build this place. We're not going to take another 3 years, another 7 years, another 10 years. Before we get this done, this place, we're going to do something. Yeah. I said, we are going to do something. Yeah. If you are part of that we, where are you there? You will do it. Look at this now. We're coming to chapter 29. And he said in verse 1, he said, now I have prepared with all my might for the house of my God, the gold, for the things of gold. And then he said, the silver for the things of silver, and the brass for the things of brass, and iron for the things of iron. And then he says, onyx stones, and then and stones to set, to be set. He says, glistering stones, and of all the divers, of all divers colors, and all manner of precious stones, and marble, and stones in abundance. Look up here. God said, you will not build. Because, you know, another passage, you have been a man of war. And because you shed so much blood, I will not allow you to build. Another person is coming who will do the building. And so this man, David, he didn't grudge God. He wasn't angry against God. He wasn't unhappy about it. He didn't feel disappointed. He said, okay, if I cannot build, all the provision to build that place, I'm going to provide. Isn't that a wonderful heart? Isn't that the kind of heart God is giving you today? That you will bring all the provision. And everything will eventually be prepared. It doesn't matter that it is Solomon or it is a brother so-and-so or a sister so-and-so that is on duty now to get it done. But all the provision will come from all of us in Jesus' name. It says, moreover, because I have set my affection to the house of my God. I'm not allowed to build it, but I set my affection. I put my love there. I've set my affection to the house of my God. I have of mine own proper good, of my own property. You have property? Even if it means selling a car, you will sell. Even if it means selling your, I mean, we want to build something and do something for the Almighty God, something that will say, I'm not going to allow my own house. Who am I? Who am I? And who are you? Look at the God of heaven and the creator of the heavens and the earth. Look at where he is and look at where we worship and look at the Almighty God. Look at everything. He owns the whole earth. The earth is the Lord and the fullness thereof. And yet the house I'm living in is better than the house we build for worshiping God. And yet the chairs we're sitting on in the house of the living God is so poor. It's like, you know, we took them away from those who have put it under the dust, under the sun for a long time. And we say, you know, if you, they cannot use it for party, they cannot use it for dancing, they cannot use it for nightclub. Okay, church can use it. Because we church, we don't appreciate something nice, everything is going to change. Because can you sit on those chairs in your own house? And when we come to you and we visit you, what kind of chairs do you have? And David is saying, because of who God is, I prepared something for him. I prepared this great provision. Wonderful, David. I pray that that same heart God will give to you and give to me in Jesus' name. He said, I have prepared of my own good for this holy house of the Lord. Then he says in verse 4, even 3,000 talents of gold. That was a lot of money at that time, of the gold of Ophir. And then 7,000 talents of fine of refined silver. And he says to overlay the walls of the houses therewith. He says the gold for the things of gold. And then he said the silver for the things of silver. And then he said all manner of work to be made by the hands of artificers. Now he threw the challenge to the rest of the people. He said, and who then is willing? Who then is willing? Who then is willing? Anybody there today? Who then is willing to bring money out? Anybody there today? Who then is willing to contribute his expertise? So what do we call experience? All that you have, you know how to do this, how to do this, how to do that. Who then is willing? You know, sometimes you can tell some people, because you know, I used to meet people one-on-one in our church when, you know, the work was not this large, and then somebody will come and he'll be talking to me and he'll say, Pastor, you know this, and I like to ask questions from people, and I will say, what do you do? And the person might say, I'm a musician. I said, tell me about that. Now you are born again. What are you going to do with your talent? Because you're not going to be in the nightclub anymore. They know all the music. They can play trumpet. They can play violin. They can play cello. They can play the keyboard. And they can play all that. And then they come to church. And then they will say, how did you find the music today? You say, well, our people, because now he's born again, he wants to be polite and nice. Our people are trying. And if I had time, I'll take him to the keyboard and say, play for me and let me see your level. And then when they put their hands on that, and such people, although they have the music talent and everything, they're just sitting at the back bench there. I invite you, come in. Don't sit at the back bench. This is your place. You'll come and use that thing for God in Jesus' name. You know, sometimes I'm talking to people and they say, you know, our church there is good. We like your doctrine. You teach Bible. But sir, can I tell you something? I look at the administration. I say, okay, before you go on, tell me, before you criticize our administration, what do you do in your place of, oh, you say, by the grace of God, my humble self, I'm a manager. I know this, I know that. I said, what? And then how many companies, how many workers do you oversee? I oversee this, I oversee this. What's your experience? They tell me the experience. And then I say, where have you traveled that? I've traveled here and there. I've attended this conference. I've won this award and this award. And when were you born again? I just born again recently, and then it's in this church. But the little I see that, you know, if our people will, you know, kind of have a good training, that this church will move here and there. I say, why don't you come in and give us seminars on administration? All the talents you have, all the knowledge you have, all the experience you have, here we are. That's why Moses said, I've done my part. I've done all the money that is needed, gold, everything that is needed. Here is it. I've contributed this, but now who is willing this day? I'm talking to willing people. I said I'm talking to willing people. The pastors may not know you. The pastors may not know what talent you have, what experience you have. They may not know. That's why we throw out the question. We say, we have this need, we have this need, we have this need. Who is willing this day to consecrate a service this day unto the Lord? There's somebody there you are willing in Jesus' name. And this one, there's no gender here. It's not like, you know, I'm a woman. If I tell them this is my experience, they'll not accept. How did you know? You judge us before talking to us. Come talk to us and say, this is what I have to offer. This is what I have to offer. I offer my own. You offer your own. We offer our own. I'm telling you, this church will get somewhere. I said this, our church will get somewhere. Now, I've spoken about the passion and the project. Now, the perspective, the godly perspective that he had. Hey, look at this in this chapter 29, the last line of chapter 29. Last line of chapter 29, it says, for the palace is not for man. For the palace is not for man. For the palace is not for man, but, tell me the rest. You are not there yet. But for the Lord God, when you give the design to an architect, you know, who want to build a church in this community, you remind them, there must be this godly perspective. It is not for man, it is for God. And when you are going to, you bring people in the choir and they're going to sing, let's remind ourselves, it is not for man, it is for God. We bring a teacher that is going to teach us the scripture and is going to teach us the word of God. We remind them, this is not for man, this is for God. They will do higher, greater, better than they do in their schools, in the places where they are teaching. We come over here and we say, we're doing for the Lord. We remind ourselves, this is not for man, this is for God. Our service will be better. Our service will be greater. And our language, brethren, dear, let me remind you, I don't know whether you ever listen to the radio. I don't know whether you ever listen to those in our place here. It's a Yoruba language. You listen to the radio and the way they use the Yoruba language, you will almost want to, you know, leave the English side and go to the Yoruba side because they use that language in a dexterous manner. And when they, you know, join some vocabularies that you have never heard, it's like they have been reading those old Yoruba books, you know, recently, and you enjoy the language. But you know, we come to the church and then we're preaching and somebody is interpreting there, and the people that understand our local language, they say they murder the language, they destroy the language. How could you speak like that? In fact, I'm going to leave that you know, Yoruba Igbo class and I'm going to join English. Why? Because we do not know, we're interpreting and we're translating for God and not for man. The people that do it in the world, they put everything they've got into it, and from now on you'll put everything into it, that we will enjoy your ministry in Jesus' name. And so we find that David, he would not do less for God than he would do for himself. Let's come to point number two, the heavenly response of the glorious king. The heavenly response of the glorious king. We're coming to 2 Samuel chapter 7. 2 Samuel, we're looking at chapter 7, and I'm reading here from verse 4. 2 Samuel chapter 7, we're looking at verse 4. And it came to pass that night that the word of the Lord came unto Nathan, saying, go and tell my servant Moses. Look up here for a moment. God didn't want Moses to build that house, but he said, go tell my servant David. Now, he is God. He could easily say, go tell David. Look up here. For example, you know, you understand that I'm probably older than, you know, most of us, and maybe you are 30 years of age, and look at, you know, how old I am, and maybe you happen to be called Stephen. And then, you know, because of my age and because of your age, I'll say, Stephen, come on here. And you know, there are people like that. They cannot say, Brother Stephen. Even when you are older than them, they cannot say, now, brother, I saw Brother Stephen yesterday. My brother, it doesn't cost you anything to add that Wonderful word. It's a word for the family. It's a word that shows that you respect me, I respect you. Don't go tell Josephine. Go tell Mary. Oh, my. You can easily add that little word. Go tell Sister Mary. And you know, when we hear that, we know you accept us. We're part of the family. The language we use while we're talking to each other, I think things will change in Jesus' name. Somebody there saying, okay, that's just me. I just say, you know, after all, we should be humble. And if we call him Stephen, if we call him Mary, what's the big deal in that? Well, if you call him brother, what's the big deal in that? If you call him her sister, what's the big deal in that? Why don't you do like God did? And God said, go tell my servant David. You know, sometimes when I used to answer the questions, question and answer, and I want to, you know, call a particular person, I'll say, yes, my sister there. And somebody there will be grumbling, why is the pastor saying my sister there? Does he even know her? How do you know I don't know her? And that brother there, thank you, my brother Stephen there. Is he my brother? Of course, yes. So we should use languages that show that we accept each other, we love each other, and we appreciate each other. Look at what God is saying. He says, go tell my servant David. And then he goes on to say, thus says the Lord, shall thou build me an house for me to dwell in? Then he goes on to say, he had not dwelt in that before. Well, what God was saying here is, God said, no, don't build a house for me. God said, I like that initiative, I appreciate that initiative, but I don't want you to build that house. Come to First Chronicles chapter 17. First Chronicles chapter 17. And I'm reading here from verse 3. First Chronicles chapter 17. And we're looking at verse 3. Are you there? And it came to pass that same night that the word of God came to Nathan saying, go and tell David my servant. My servant David, my servant, the same thing. Thus says the Lord, thou shalt not build me an house to dwell in. Thou shalt not build me an house to dwell in. Stop there for a moment. Now, he is God. He doesn't have to explain anything to us. He doesn't have to, you know, say the reason why he shouldn't build a house. Do you know there are leaders and fathers and mothers and elderly people? Well, because we're elderly, because I'm the pastor, I am, you know, the general superintendent, I am the state overseer. Hey, don't do that thing. Sir, can you explain to me? I said, don't do that thing. You hear? Obey. No complaint. And they were confused. What did I do? Why is he telling me not to do that? And I have a good intention. Are they suspecting me that I have a bad motive? I have a bad intention? Do they think I'm going to spoil the work of God? Has somebody told him something about me that they do not appreciate, and they're not telling me? And you just told me point blank, don't do that thing. You know, God doesn't act like that. And if we're going to be children of God, we act like God. Explain, why shouldn't you do that thing? Why shouldn't he go that direction? It will bring understanding in the family of God. It will bring appreciation in the family of God. Look at this. Look at this in verse 5 now. For I have not dwelt in an house since the day that I brought you up. I brought up Israel unto this day. But I've gone from tent to tent and from one tabernacle to another. He said, Nathan, when you tell him, you must tell him why. You must tell him why I say no. We're learning from God. And when you tell somebody, don't do nothing, don't go that way, don't just say, I'm the leader. If he is an obedient worker in the church, he should just obey. Don't ask me any question. I'm not going to explain anything to you. I'm going to test your submission. Don't test people too much, because you know sometimes the test can crush us. Explain to us why we shouldn't do that sin. In fact, if you look at 2 Chronicles now, 2 Chronicles, I'm reading from chapter 6. 2 Chronicles chapter 6, and I'm reading here from verse 7 and verse 8. 2 Chronicles chapter 6, we're reading from verse 7. Open your Bible. Are you there now? Okay, thank you. 2 Chronicles chapter 6, I'm reading from verse 7. Now, it was in the heart of David my father to build an house for the name of the Lord God of Israel. But the Lord said unto David my father, for as much as it was in thine heart to build an house for my name, thou didst well in that it was in thine heart. Thou didst well in that it was in thine heart. Look up here. You know, somebody used to say, when you want to, maybe you want to offer help, and the person said, oh, thank you very much, that already I've had a way, I'm going to do that thing, so thank you. And then the person will add, I take the thought for the action. I take the thought for the action. Now, even though you are not doing it, I accept. It's like you have done it. That's what God was telling David. He said, David, I love you. I appreciate you. I take the a thought for the action. Look at this, that it was in thine heart to build an house for my name. Thou didst well. Thou didst well that it was in your heart. Look at verse 9. Notwithstanding, thou shalt not build the house, but thy son, which shall come forth out of thy loins, he shall build the house for my name. And so we thank the Lord for the Lord himself explain why he shouldn't. In fact, he told him that he had been a man of blood. He had had many, many wars. Because of that, he wasn't going to build the house. And now God bless David beyond his expectation, that he even thought about it. Even though he wasn't allowed to do it, God said, I'm going to bless you for even the thought. We're coming to 2 Samuel chapter 7. 2 Samuel chapter 7. And we're reading here from verse 10 to verse 12. Verse 10 to verse 12. It says in verse 10, moreover, I will appoint a place for my people Israel, and will plant them, that they may dwell in a place of their own, and move no more. Neither shall the children of wickedness afflict them any more as before time. Somebody is going to say amen. Amen. Because of that thing in your heart, you know, it pays to serve Jesus. Have you heard that before? You know, you might want to write that and remember every time you feel tired and you say, after all, you know, what is coming out of this? Remember, it pays to serve Jesus. And that's what we're learning here, that God said, because this is in your heart, see what I'm going to do. All those oppressors will not oppress you anymore. All the people that harass people's life in the day, in the night, they will not harass you anymore in Jesus' name. And look at this in verse 11. And since the time that I commanded the judges to be over my people Israel, and have caused thee to rest from all thine enemies. Thank God, this is the year of resting from all my enemies. I'm saying it for myself. It's a year of resting from all your enemies. You know, fasting and praying and agonizing and rolling and saying, God, remember me. Look at this, my child, a son in my flesh. Look at this, my so-and-so, a son in my flesh. And look at this and look at that. You know, after this time, there's nothing to look at. You only look at Jesus, the author and the finisher of your faith. Because all those things that harass your life, they are coming to end this year in Jesus' name. And then look at this, verse 11. In verse 11, it says, also. Everybody help me say, also. Also the Lord telleth thee that he will build you an house. I didn't hear a good amen. It says, because this was in your heart, I will build you an house. My bachelor brother dear, what that means is that he'll give you a wife, he'll give you a home. And my sister, spinster sister there, what that means is that it's going to give you a bone of your bone and flesh of your flesh. You are going to have a good husband. And we're going to celebrate and rejoice with you this year. Because God said, I will build you an house. Brother, sister, you are married. It means that if there's no child yet, I'll build you an house. And miracle children are coming this year. And then look at verse 12 now. It says, and when thy days be fulfilled, and thou shalt sleep with thy fathers, I will set up thy seed after thee. I will set up thy seed after thee. And it says, which shall proceed out of thy bowels, and I will establish his kingdom. Those children were not even born yet for David. The ones that were going to reign, and God said, he's already prophesying and promising good things concerning them. Generations to come, your seed will prosper. We're looking at verse 16. In verse 16, and thine house and thy kingdom shall be established forever before thee. Brother, are you worried about your children? Don't worry, God will establish them. Are you concerned about your offspring? Don't worry about them. God said he will establish them. And God is not a liar. He will do it in Jesus' name. And thy throne shall be established forever. According to all these words and according to all this vision, so did Nathan speak to David. After all, it pays to even think about it. Even though I'm not going to build it, even though God is saying you will not build it, that the thought was even in my heart. And some people say, I'm not going to say anything. You know, there are some people, they're over careful, extra careful. They're too, you know, they think too much of what happened in the past. This is occurring to me now. And I know the pastor, he always says no to me. How do you know? We're always saying no to you. Okay, this in my heart now. I don't want to tell Nathan. I want to keep this between me and God. And, you know, because if I tell him, what if he says no? Tell him. Look at what happened to David here. He told Nathan. Nathan said, okay, go and do it. And then he came back the following day. Nathan is coming. I hope Nathan is not going to change what he told me yesterday, because, you know, I know the way they normally act. Don't talk like that. This is a new year. Everybody say, this is a new year. And so, you know, Nathan came and Nathan said, David, I have a message for you. Okay, what's it? That thing we discussed yesterday. You remember what I told you? Yes, you told me. Everything good in your heart, go do it. I came to tell you that God said no. I knew. I shouldn't have told him. And that's why some people are so reserved. I won't tell them. Tell us. Come and tell me. What are you? I said, come and tell me. Will you talk to me? I said, will you talk to me? What if I say no? Will you talk to me again? Let's keep talking. Let's keep talking. Because, you know, God can pass something through me and pass it through to your life. And keep on talking to those overseers. Keep on talking to those group coordinators, group pastors, whatever it was. What if they say no? Keep on talking to them. You know, one day heaven will say yes. It will be a big yes, a wonderful yes, though. So all the things that may happen in communication between us, don't let that hinder us to become so careful. I can't talk to anybody. I can't relate to anybody. Why? Because in this new year, I can see your horizon. And I can see the blessing of God. I can see the heavens opening, and the heavens will pour down great blessings upon every life in Jesus' name. I almost could mention your name, but I'm not going to do it, because I know something good is coming your way. We're coming to point number three now. The higher reward of a greater kingdom. The higher reward of a greater kingdom. See what the Lord is telling us in 2 Samuel chapter 7. I'm reading from the latter part of verse 11. 2 Samuel chapter 7. We've read it before. We're going to read it again. 2 Samuel chapter 7, second part of verse 11. And also the Lord telleth thee. And he cannot lie. The Lord telleth thee, and it's not a mistake. And the Lord telleth thee, it's your name, it's you. This is coming to you. And the Lord telleth thee that he will make thee an house. There's no harm in saying a second amen there. Look at verse 16 again. And thine house and thy kingdom shall be established forever before thee. Thy throne shall be established forever. Well, I'm going to summarize everything for you now. And he promised him security. That you'll find in verse 10. He said, there will be security. All your enemies, they are silenced in Jesus' name. Number two, he promised him posterity. Posterity. He said, no, you're not going to remain like this. You're going to have children. And the children that will come out of you, they will build the kingdom. Security, number one. Posterity, number two. Authority. It was going to give him royal authority and power. Authority is coming upon your life. Behold, I give unto you power over all the power of the enemy. Serpents and scorpions, you will tread them under your feet. And then you say, no power, no authority, and no ability, and no demonic power will be able to hurt you in Jesus' name. He promised him perpetuity. Perpetuity, that means on and on and on and on, he'll continue. And then he promised him prosperity. Prosperity. The times of living from hand to mouth, that time is over. The Lord is going to grant prosperity into your life. He promised him nobility. Nobility. That means you're not just going to be among the common people. He'll make your name great as the names of the great men of the world and the great women on earth in Jesus' name. And then he promised him the key of opportunity. Opportunity. Look at what's coming on your life. Just because you're involved in the work of the Lord. Just because I'm going to do that for God, keep on planning. God is going to bless that plan. And then you're going to have security, you have posterity, you have authority, you have perpetuity, you have prosperity, you have nobility, and you have opportunity. Let me end with this story. Remember what we're talking about? We're talking about rising from disappointment to his appointment. There was one family many years ago, and the family, their surname is Clark from Scotland. And Clark and his wife, they had 9 children, and they had this big desire and dream to go to USA, to go to America, and to emigrate and go and live there. And so they, he sold his property, he sold everything, and then told the whole family, we're going to America, we're going to settle down there. And then they bought their ticket and they made their reservations. The place they will go in America, everything was totally settled. And then just 1 week to the time of that time, it was ship. They are going to take a ship. One week to the sale of that ship, a dog beat the youngest child. And the youngest child then was taken to the hospital. And then the doctors at that time, they didn't have all the vaccines they have today. They checked up the boy, and the dog had, run away. They didn't see the doctor test anything. And they told Mr. Clark, your son might have contracted rabies because of that dog bite. And what they did that time, they will kind of put that child in a place, and then they hung a sign on the door. Nobody can come in. The father could not come to see the boy. The mother could not come to see the boy. It was totally in the care of the doctors. And they said they were going to keep him like that and watch him for 2 weeks. And the sheep was to leave in 1 week. That means the sheep would have left, and all the family would be left behind. And when they released that boy, they've missed that opportunity of traveling. And they've sold everything. They've said bye-bye to everybody. And, we're going to America. And this happened. And the child was kept there in that room, quarantined. And so this man, Mr. Clark, was angry against God. He was bitter against God. And why should this happen? We planned everything. God has totally devastated my life. That's what we call disappointment. But on the 15th of April 1912, a few days after that ship left, That ship sank in the ocean. Everybody in that ship perished. And Mr. Clark and the wife and the children knew if they had been there, the family would have been forgotten forever. He came and prostrated before God. God, you never make a mistake. Every disappointment is His appointment. You know, in your life, don't grumble, don't complain. Whatever God stops, He stops it for a reason. Were it not for that child that was beaten by that dog, all that family would have died. And then in 2 weeks, they released the boy. The boy was all right. The whole family was all right. And the whole family was kept alive. God will keep you alive. He may do things in a way you don't understand. But you know, God is saying you are bought with a price. You are born again. You are a child of God. Your name is in the book of life in heaven. He's thinking about you. He's planning for you. Anything He allows, don't say, I'm disappointed. Cut that word out of your mouth. Is the disappointment will be His appointment. Rise up and let us pray. His appointment. You are precious in the sight of God. God is thinking about your life. No disappointment. No delay. No denial. Replace that word delay with hope in Christ. I hope in the Lord. I hope in the Lord. I hope in the Lord. Replace that denial with heavenly help. Let an H replace that D in your life. He has marked you down for blessing. No disappointment in your life. All that remains is His appointment. His promises are yes and amen in your life. He is good. He is good. He's thinking about you. He's planning for you. Your life is precious. Your family is precious. Wipe those tears away. No reason to cry. If you know anything good you can do for the house of God, go ahead. Make provision. Make yourself available. Be willing and consecrate your service to the Lord this day. You are not doing it for man. You are doing it for God, your heavenly Father. Don't hold back. Don't hold back. Don't hold your talent back. Don't hold your experience back. Don't hold your provisions back. Don't hold your knowledge back. Squander your life for the Lord. And throw your whole life to the Lord. No reservation. You'll be surprised how He rewards you. And you know other people who should be in the workforce, run after them. Reach after them. Bring them in. We need everybody. Make all necessary provision to serve the Lord more. Encourage other people too. Those who are discouraged and are thinking of disappointment, remind them there's no disappointment in Christ. That seeming disappointment is His appointment. In Jesus' name we pray.
Amen.
No disappointment in my life. What is the person I'm talking about? Every disappointment is his appointment.
Amen.
Give me a good amen.
Amen.
Your life will be beautiful.
Amen.
Your family will prosper.
Amen.
And that thing that you felt disappointed about in the past, you are going to find out this year, there's going to be an appointment in your life.
Amen.
Job, the Lord will provide.
Amen.
Family, the Lord will provide.
Amen.
And the joy of the Lord will be your strength in Jesus' name. Everything that happened until yesterday, if they are negative, they are reversed tonight in Jesus' name. Keep up that. And Father, in the name of Jesus, we thank you for the assurance you have given us. There is no disappointment anymore in any of our lives. Every brother, every sister, every young person over here, Lord, we cancel all the disappointments in Jesus' name. We change that D to an H. And we know hope has come. Heavenly blessing has come. Heavenly help has come. And we pray, oh Lord, you set our feet on a new platform, even from today in Jesus' name. I pray you wipe the tears of our faces away. Crush all the power of the enemy and all the things that make us bend our backs and look down, and then we're sorrowful and we're depressed. No depression anymore. No depression anymore. Cancel everything in Jesus' name. Whatever might have happened in the past, we didn't understand. We know you understand. And you are going to turn everything for the good of our lives in Jesus' name. Lord, I pray for every brother, every sister here. Let your blessings be showered upon them. Retain an open heaven on everyone. Blessing on everyone. And I pray, Lord, whatever might be our childish action in the past, our whatever mistakes we made in the past, I just pray you forgive and forget in Jesus' name. Let new life begin. Let new life begin. Let new life begin. And I pray, Lord, that from this day, joy, happiness, goodness, health, prosperity, provision, and protection, and Lord, the desire to keep on serving you, you grant to everyone in Jesus' name. Your work will prosper in our hands. Your work will prosper in every district. Your work will prosper in every group. Your work will prosper in every city, and this work will prosper in every state and region in Jesus' name. In every nation, this work will prosper. Set a special mark upon your people. When enemies see them, they will run away. When demons and devils see them, they will run away. And when angels see them, they'll bring your blessing. And I pray that from this day, testimony in every mouth, joy in every heart, success in every endeavor, and prosperity in the work you have given us to do. Lord, we know that things are different now. We are not going to be the same again. Our language will change. Our thoughts will change. Our disposition will change. Now there is sunshine. All the darkness and the gloom is gone. Confirm your blessing upon every life. We thank you because we know you have answered. In Jesus' name we pray.